Let's say you had the task of printing the first 50 Fibonacci numbers. Now this task is much harder than it seems at first. Let's go through the traditional method of writing a Fibonacci sequence in code and see why that technique will not work. So I'm going to create a new class here and call it Classic Fibonacci. And then I'm going to just write the Fibonacci code as you know it. So starting with this empty shell of a class, I'm going to put in a main program, and now we're going to write the method that's going to do the actual work, and we'll create a static method there, and we'll put in the two base cases. The base case for 0 will be 0, and 1 will be 1, and then for all the other cases, they'll be the recursive cases where we'll add the two previous results together and return that. Let's run this now and see how well it works. Okay, here we are running the program, and you can see we're up to the 40s already, and things seem to be going well along. We do notice already that the program is starting to slow in terms of calculating the last few numbers that we need, but it's not prohibitively slow. We can just wait it out and see if we can get the first 50 numbers printed. Things seem to be going fairly well along until we got to the I value of 47, and all of a sudden we got a negative number here for the Fibonacci number, which seems quite odd. Can you figure out why it would be if we added these two previous entries together that we would suddenly get a negative number? Doesn't seem plausible. If you think about it, you'll probably realize what's happened here is that we've had an integer overflow. The reason for that, of course, is that there is a limit to how large an integer Java can support in its primitive int variable type. Notice that the 48th number, by the way, is back to being positive. That's because it was calculated as the sum of the two previous entries. However, this number, as you'll probably recognize, is completely meaningless because it was calculated using another meaningless number, which was the previous answer. So you can see that after entry number 46, we no longer get valid answers for the future Fibonacci sequences. So what can we do about this? Do we give up entirely, or is there some other way to get at the higher Fibonacci numbers by finding some sort of data type that holds a larger number of digits than the primitive integer inside Java? To help solve this problem, what we're going to do now is we're going to introduce a new data type that's already been pre-built into the Java math library. That data type is called BigInteger, so to use that, we're going to create another version of this Fibonacci code. This one I'm going to call it Big Fibonacci. And I'm going to start off by copying all the code from Classic Fibonacci and putting it into Big Fibonacci. So here we are now inside of the Big Fibonacci class, and so far it's identical to what we had previously. I'm going to refactor this code a little bit, and the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to add an import statement, which is going to import the new data type that we want. Now this Big Integer class, as its name implies, holds more digits than the traditional primitive int type available in Java. However, the price we have to pay for that is that it's a little bit awkward to use. We can't use the traditional math operators, plus, minus, things like that, not even the double equal sign. So we're going to have to treat it more like a class member, and so we're going to have to make some adjustments to our code to accommodate this data type. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to make a minor change to the main program, and right here we're going to call this Fibonacci method using the big integer version of I instead of the int version of I, which it currently is. Okay, so with that adjustment in place, I'm also going to define a constant that we're going to be using a couple of places. This is not absolutely necessary, but it does make the code a little bit more readable and makes it more convenient. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to convert this method, which is right now uses an int as the input and an int as the output, and I'm going to convert both the input and the output to using a big integer instead of using these regular little ints here. Okay, now the next thing that I have to do is I have to go through my code, and everywhere there is a reference to an operator such as the double equals or subtraction. I have to replace these with the equivalents that are used in the BigInteger class, because BigInteger doesn't use the double equals. Since it is a class or an object, it's going to use the dot equals. Okay, our next problem is that 0 itself is a little integer, and I happens to now be a big integer here. And so we have to be careful that we have the two same kinds of data types when we're doing the equals. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the big integer version of 0. Now it turns out that both the numbers 0 and 1 are defined as public final constants inside the big integer class. They're statics, and so I'm going to use that version now of 0. Okay, this is already predefined for us in the big integer class. And once again, instead of returning a 0, we're going to return the big integer version of that. Likewise here, I want to make sure that I use the dot equals. And once again, I want to use the big integer version of 1. Now here, it's gotten a little bit more complicated, because we have the minus 1, we have to do some subtraction, plus we have to do some addition. So I'm going to refactor this code into two different parts. I'm going to say big integer. So I've commented out the previous calls that were used in the recursive case, and I've refactored the code like this, and I've broken it up into two pieces. I just want to make mention of the fact that where the subtraction sign was previously used and can be used with the little int, when we're using the big integer, we have to use the subtract method. Likewise, when we're adding, where we had this plus sign before, I've now had to use the add method. Notice that big integer 1 and big integer 0 are defined in the integer big integer class, but 2 is not available for the user, so I had to use my own definition up here of 2 to make the code clean. Now what we're going to do is we're going to just compile and run this. Oops, looks like I forgot another parenthesis there. Okay, and then let's see what happens. Now, you might expect that it's all going to work fine now, but we're going to run into a different problem now. Let's have a look. Okay, you can see that it's going far along, except now you notice that the slowdown is already occurring in the 30s instead of in the 40s. Why is this happening? Well, we still have the slowdown resulting from the stack use, but now instead of doing our operations using a primitive integer or little int, we're now using a class, big integer, and so there's some overhead associated with that. And so you can see that it's going to take us an extremely long time to get the 50 numbers that we want. Each successive number that's being printed out is taking longer and longer. Is there a way we could speed up the program significantly and get our results almost instantaneously instead of having to wait a long time? Well, it turns out that there is. For our final solution, we're going to write one more version of our Fibonacci. This time we're going to take the recursion out of the method and use a loop solution instead, and this one is going to turn out to be far faster than the other solutions. I've defined a constant here to show how many Fibonacci sequences, how many numbers we want in total. We only want 50, but I wanted to show you how fast this algorithm is, so I've set the max all the way up here to 90. And the key here is we're going to use this static array to calculate all the Fibonacci numbers ahead of time, instead of using a recursive strategy. So what we're going to do is we're going to load the static array up with the two base cases from our previous recursive algorithm, and we're going to calculate all the other answers simply by adding the two previous answers together. Notice one key difference here, so that when we calculate each answer, we only need to look at the two previous. We don't need to do any calculations that are going all the way back to zero. And now we're going to just print the answers as we get them. Let's try this out now and see what we get. Okay, you can see that the answers come up almost instantaneously, and we can see that the big integer is doing its job, and we can get a large number of digits here now, which we couldn't with our little primitives.